So our first question for you, what do you think about redrawing borders so that the Arab population, I assume the Palestinian population, would be reunited with other Arab countries around them? And therefore,
where Israelis will be united with Palestinian and redraw the borders?
There's nothing sacred about the borders. What about redrawing Israel's borders? So that Israel has, in short, more Jews and fewer Muslims. There is nothing sacred about the borders of Israel. They were the armistice lines of 1948-49 war and 1967 war. They are certainly changeable. I think it's a perfectly reasonable idea to move them so that the Palestinian entity, whatever it might be in the future, will contain more Palestinians, and Israel will have more Israelis or Jews. It's a very reasonable idea. It will be difficult to implement, in part because the Arab population of Israel is loath to leave Israel. Israel has a far more stable political environment, has the rule of law, has a far better economy. And if you suddenly find yourself, for example, in the Palestinian Authority, you find yourself much worse off in many ways than you have been in Israel. So it might be hard to push out Arabs who have been resident and citizens of Israel for decades. But I think in principle, it's a legitimate idea to soften the edges of what is otherwise a very difficult population problem. In other words, it's not ethnic cleansing. It's not moving people, throwing people out. It's redrawn borders. I can see no moral or legal or political problem with that.
How do you respond to radical groups like Mezrei Karta or other groups who claim that Zionism and Judaism are two separate things, and that if they are the same, Zionism is a corrupting force within Judaism?
Well, it's not groups like Natura Karta, it is Natura Karta alone, and I think it has some 60 people in the world, so it's not exactly a major force. It's a fringe of a fringe of a fringe. Natura Karta is a very strange group that believes that Israel's coming to existence as a state was an infringement of God's will. They hate Israel. They hate Israel so much that they join with Israel's enemies like Yasser Arafat and Mahmoud Ahmadinejad, and they take the money. This was proven a few years ago that they were on the dole of the PLO. I don't think this fringe of a fringe is worth a lot of consideration. What is a more serious element are the non-Zionist Haredi groups, ultra-Orthodox Jewish groups that live in Israel, but don't serve in the military and generally keep their distance from the notion of a Jewish state. They're non-Zionist, but they're not actually working against Israel as this tiny fringe is.
The next question is pretty appropriate considering we're on a college campus, one which doesn't currently have a program in Israel for study abroad. Do you feel that it is currently safe for Jewish students to be traveling and studying in Israel? And how do you convey this to people who feel that it's not?
Well, statistically, the most dangerous thing you can do in Israel is go by car somewhere. There are many, many more deaths annually from vehicular accidents than from terrorism. Terrorism gets so much attention in part because it's political and in part because it's rare. When terrorism is taking place on a weekly basis, you don't hear about it so much. Like you don't hear about car fatalities. Now, terrorism in Israel is a very small problem at this time. The three murders in Eilat a few days ago were the first in 9 months. This is not something that's statistically significant. Yes, it's there. It's a tremendous problem in Palestinian-Israeli relations. But no, from the point of view of the visitor, I can't see that it's significant.
Do you believe that it was a strategic mistake for Israel to withdraw from the West Bank?
Thank you, my God. The current government planned to leave the West Bank, but never got around to it. Some small problems got in the way. But the Israeli government has in recent years unilaterally withdrawn from Lebanon in 2000 and Gaza in 2005. In both cases, there was a hope that by leaving a difficult, violent situation in southern Lebanon or Gaza, Israel would improve its security. This was not to be the case, in part because of the prism that I mentioned to you before. By leaving unilaterally, the Israelis conveyed a message of weakness and vulnerability, which enhanced the Palestinian sense of ambition and potential. It increased the Palestinian sense that they could, in fact, eliminate Israel. And in part, it made life much more difficult on the ground. Whether it be the Qassams hitting Shderot near Gaza, or the barrage of thousands of missiles from Lebanon hitting northern Israel last summer, hundreds of thousands, over a million Israeli lives have been disrupted by these unilateral withdrawals. They were terrible ideas. Fortunately, the notion of a West Bank withdrawal is now in storage and not likely to happen anytime soon. Such withdrawals can only take place in the condition of resolution, of end of war, of conflict being over. You can't withdraw from territory and expect your enemy to be nice to you.
What's your opinion on Jimmy Carter's current political situation as well as Israel?
You heard that I founded and published the Middle East Quarterly. It's a journal that has just published the full account by Kenneth Stein on the Jimmy Carter book. Kenneth Stein is a historian of the Middle East who traveled for some years with Carter, was his chief Middle East aide, was the head of the Carter Center for some time, and abruptly, 2 months ago, resigned from the Carter Center in protest against this book. The article titled My Problem with Jimmy Carter's Book just went up, I think, last week. And it details the extent of the problems of Carter's book. Carter steals maps, vandals facts, and to a certain extent must be intentionally distorting. Stein gives his handwritten notes from a meeting that he and Carter had with Hafez al-Assad, the president of Syria in 1990, and those are the only notes that Carter had at his disposal from the meeting now, some 17 years ago. And they're a total variance with each other. Carter just overrode what the factual record showed to be the case. Stein suggests that the Carter has an abiding anger at Menachem Begin, the prime minister of Israel during his presidency, and at Israel more broadly, for having contributed to his electoral defeat in 1980. But one of the reasons why he lost to Ronald Reagan, he believes, says Stein, is that the Israelis didn't cooperate with him in the way that he wanted, and he's angry. And he documents how ideas that Carter had back in the 80s, of attitudes that Carter had back then, annoyance, have evolved 25 years later into rage, of the sort that is expressed in this book.
How do you believe that the Palestinians would ever accept a defeat when the war that they fight against the Jews is a completely religious war?
How would the Palestinians accept defeat if it's a religious war? Well, first, in the first place, you can be defeated in religious wars. There's nothing that suggests that religious war must go on indefinitely. Religious wars end on all wars. Secondly, it's not exactly religious war. Over the course of 100 years, the Arab Zionist War, if you call it that, has had four different eras on the Arab side. Initially, the Arab goal was Greater Syria, in place of the Zionist, the Yishuv, the Zionist, the proto-state. And then secondly came an Arab nationalist goal of the idea of a single Arab country from Morocco to Iraq. And thirdly came the idea of a secular Palestinian state under the PLO. And finally now we're in a fourth stage of Islamist ambition, Hamas. Islam. So from Syria to Arab to Palestinian to Islamic, you see, of course, four changes. Each time, the sense that the prior effort had failed, let's try something new. I have no idea what the fifth one might be, but it could go back to one of the prior, it could go to something new. But it's not exactly a religious war, it is a war in which the side that's fighting Israel has redefined itself several times and is still seeking, in some fashion, its final identity. Who is it? What kind of state, if it won, would replace Israel? All this is very fluid, amazingly fluid. In fact, I can't think of any other conflict where one side has redefined itself and its goals as much as it did in Israel versus Israel.
Before we continue with the questioning, I want to let everybody know there's an email list going around. It's Mr. Pipes' email list if you want to be informed of future speaking engagements and articles that are published. It's completely optional, but please sign up if you are still interested.
Completely free, too.
You made a lot of mention about radical Islam tonight and Islamists. The question is, what is the distinction between radical Islam and traditional Islam?
Traditional Islam is a religion, and indeed a religion that is not that dissimilar from Judaism. That it is a religion that primarily focuses the believer's behavior on laws, in contrast to Christianity, which is primarily about faith. Radical Islam is the transformation of this religion into a political ideology. It has its basis in Islam. But it's a misogynist, anti-Semitic, anti-Christian, anti-Hindu, jihadist, suicidal version of Islam. It is taking Islam and transforming it into a political ideology. So that, for example, a century ago, there were really no Islamic views on economics. Today, there are many major books on the subject. It's turning Islam into something that deals with all of life, that is totalitarian, that is comparable in its extent, in its ambition, and in its methods to fascism and communism. It is a radical utopian ideology, very modern in its essence, drawing on Islamic precepts, very modern in its means and its goals. So from an American perspective, it presents the third such challenge. We defeated the fascists in World War II, the communists in the Cold War, and now we face the Islamists. And let me just add that vital in this war are the moderate Muslims, the Muslims who reject the Islamist message, because it is they. It is not they who will provide the aircraft carriers, but it is they who ultimately will provide an alternative to radical Islam, who will offer Islam that is modern, and good neighborhood. There's only Muslims who can offer some alternative. That project of coming up with an alternative to radical Islam is in its infancy. It's weak, it's fractured. There are few successes it can point to, but it is the salvation. It is the hope for both Muslims and non-Muslims. It should both go beyond the scourge of radical Islam.
As a follow-up question, how can we as Western culture develop and continue to mobilize these more moderate Muslims?
Well, continue is a really important word. Starting would be more likely. It is a matter of looking for them, endorsing them, funding them, celebrating them. It is a matter of learning enough about Islam so I can discern the radicals from the moderates. And this is a very difficult project. Let me give you one example. The British government employs Tariq Ramadan as a spokesman for moderate Islam who goes around the United Kingdom and explains to Muslim youths how they shouldn't be radicalized, they shouldn't be violent. The United States government excludes Tariq Ramadan from its soil, and specifically from a professorship at Notre Dame University, because he's considered a supporter of terrorism. Now, if someone is prominent with a bibliography that is as long as my arm, is the subject of such different interpretations, how does one figure out who someone who hasn't written books and spoken endlessly to the media, what that person is thinking? It's a very difficult process, but I think it's critical. And what one finds, in fact, is, for example, the U.S. government and its many agencies has over and over again chosen the radicals to represent modern Islam, and in this fashion has both encouraged them and given them status and simultaneously discouraged the moderates who are left out and who are pushed to the side. It's a real tough problem. It's going to be one of the great problems facing us in the next years. And what's happened of late is that many Westerners, many Americans, have come to the conclusion there's no such thing as modern Islam. All Islam is the enemy. I can understand that, especially when I started looking at this topic only after 9/11. Headings, jihad, honor killings of women, it's an unpleasant picture. But I, who have been in this field since the late 60s, who have lived in the Middle East, who have seen another side of Islam, can tell you that it's not all like that. It need not be like that. That there are plenty of Muslims who don't want to live under Islamic law, who don't endorse it. It's that they're quiet, they're cautious, they're fearful. They need to be emboldened, they need to be brought out. That is something that we as a society have done poorly until now.
How can Israel win the battle in the media? Something that it appeared they were unable to do with situations like Hana and the doctored photographs or the song.
Israel has profound media problems. The Israeli mentality is to get it done and let facts speak for themselves. And that was a functional approach in the early days of Zionism, when it was a fairly obscure movement, but it's not today. And I would have said that, for example, in the war last summer with the Lebanese force, with Hezbollah, a media type should have been at the war, in the war room, right there, helping to make decisions, because how that war was perceived was no less consequential than how it was actually fought. And yet, the Israelis are tone deaf to it. The second problem is that the Israeli media itself tends to be really hostile to the Israeli government and Israeli Zionist principles and so on. So you have a problem with far left media, far further left than our media in this country, babbling away at these Israelis. If all you know is Hebrew, you're pretty much stuck. You only know what this biased and hostile media is saying about the Israeli government. And that media in turn, that Israeli media in turn, has profound influence on all the other media that are in Israel. Israel's media tends, newspapers and television stations, magazines from around the world have represented us there. They are the leading media of Israel, namely not the Swedish dailies or the Japanese television station, but by Israeli media themselves. So they have a real problem, a profound problem, and I have seen no improvement, no awareness of this, no steps taken to make it better.
What are your thoughts on the recent swearing in of an Arab minister into the Israeli government?
I think his name is Majd Galil. He's a minister without portfolio. He's from the Labour Party. I don't know a whole lot about him. As a symbol, it's a nice gesture. As a reality, I don't know enough to comment.
The question is, with the students who left this evening, they're right now, you're probably preaching to the choir. How do we get this message out to students who aren't willing to sit through and listen to the entire story?
Well, they did hear 15 minutes. I'm not sure everyone here is in the choir. I suspect there are a few disagreements with me on some other profound points. In general, I think it's fairly hopeless to try and convince people who hold diametrically opposed viewpoint. There's not much chance I will shift 180 degrees, nor I will shift anyone 180 degrees to me. The real dialogue, the real influence, is over those who are not quite sure where they stand. I know pretty well where I stand on the Arab-Israeli conflict, on Islam, radical Islam, terrorism, American foreign policy in the Middle East. These are subjects I've worked on for decades. But there are plenty of subjects that I don't follow. I look for guidance. I look for interesting, articulate presentations. And that's where writing, speaking, going on television, going on radio, talking to one's friends, talking to seatmates on airplanes, that's what will make the difference, is by presenting a convincing case for what one believes to people who are not quite sure. And that is a very substantial number of people on a university or in the general public. So focus not on those who vehemently disagree with you, focus on those whose minds are open and see if you can influence them.
As a former employee of the U.S. State Department, rather than a win-lose dichotomy, can you offer an alternative diplomatic process that would simultaneously accomplish your goals, but at the same time not cause bloodshed?
Well, the word bloodshed, let me take exception. I was not saying, when I talked about crushing the will, I did not say a word about how to do it. I did not say bringing out the tanks, the aircraft, the bombers, I didn't say anything. Let me note that, for example, in 1945, the fascists were defeated, a total war and unconditional surrender, massive military campaign. But in 1991, the Soviet Union disappeared without a shot. Doesn't necessarily have to require military force. To address the main point of the question, is there a diplomatic solution? I don't think so. I wish there were. I think diplomacy at this point is counterproductive. And I'm not just thinking of Arab Palestinian Israeli, but I would extend it to Egyptian Israeli, Jordanian Israeli, Syrian Israeli. Until there's a change of heart on the Arab side, until Egyptians, Jordanians, Palestinians, Syrians, and others are willing to accept Israel's existence. These are pieces of paper that have no meaning. No meaning. So no, unfavorable. I would like to see diplomacy begin once Egyptians, Palestinians, or whoever fully recognize Israel, accept it, and not try still to find ways to remedy.
What do you think will be the end of, or the resolution of, the nuclear program in Iran?
There are three potential outcomes that I can imagine. The first and by far the best is for the Iranians themselves to say no to that program. To note that it puts them in military and economic jeopardy. And for what? This is a country that has effectively no enemies today, and whose economic limitations are of its own making. But if it proceeds down this road, the possibility of hostile attacks, possibility of embargoes and the like, are vastly increased. Let us hope that the Iranians, and Iranians are politically active. This is not a Stalinist state. It's not a Saddam Hussein state where everybody is under one man's control. Let us hope that the merchants, the religious leaders, the students, and others come to the conclusion that this is a bad idea and put enough pressure on the government to stop it. That is the ideal. Failing that, the two far less happy alternatives. The second best, is that we go in and take care of the nuclear infrastructure. Delay it, destroy it. An unpleasant possibility with many negative ramifications. Price of oil, worldwide in the United States, terrorism against us. The third and worst possibility is we just let it go through. An Iranian leadership with an apocalyptic mentality has nuclear weapons, might well use them, Israel and perhaps other states. And more than that, this offers a green light to all the other states that are signatories of the Nuclear Proliferation Treaty to tear it up and build nuclear weapons, which they will promptly do. So, if there are other alternatives, let me know, but those seem to be the main three that we're facing.
In the interest of time, this will be the last question. To what do you attribute the rise of this Islamist mentality in Western culture, within Western countries?
The rise of radical Islam in the West is due to a number of factors. In the first place, the Saudis and others, especially the Saudis, began funding Islamist institutions way back in the 1960s. They have now come to fruition. The MSA, which your MSU is one part of, the Muslim Student Association, was founded in 1962. It is the Wahhabi lobby on campuses across North America. It is an Islamist organization to its core. Second reason is that Islamists flee a number of countries to come to the West. A place like Turkey has been inhospitable to Islamists for some time, less so today. So there's been a stream of immigrants from Turkey coming here, but also immigrants from other countries who seek the First Amendment, seek the obscurity, who seek the legality of Western societies. Finally, one finds that for a range of reasons, there's an alienation among a substantial number of Muslims that turns them against the host society, the United States or other societies. The most dramatic manifestation of this was the London bombings of a year and a half ago. But there are many, many such cases. One that might have particular resonance here is that less than a year ago, in March of 2006, a recent graduate of the University of North Carolina, of Iranian birth, did well in school, was well liked, rented an SUV, and took it into a pedestrian area, trying to kill as many people as possible. By good fortune, he killed nobody, didn't even harm anybody badly, but he's now in jail, and he's fulminating from jail about how much he hates the United States. Foreign policy, domestic policy, what he just sort of foul country. So that revulsion against Western ways is something that one finds in a significant number of Western Muslims. There are poll after poll coming out in Britain, and 50% of the British Muslims are supporting the idea of Islamic law. They don't want Britain as it historically has been. They want Britain under Islamic law, a complete transformation. To put in American terms, they want to replace the Constitution with the Quran. I don't think they're going to get it, so they're not here, but they're going to try for it. And this is something that those of us who do not want to live under Islamic law, and I include myself and perhaps some of you, will have to be conscious of quite against. It's not something that's a given. There's a new challenge, an unprecedented challenge in some fashion, in that a significant number of people are saying, this country needs to change. It needs to fundamentally change. Or Islamist group in Britain put it, they want to see the green flag of Islam flying over 10 Downing Street. That's the first kind of change. It's not going to go away. It's not going to be defeated of its own. It has to be understood and resisted. Thank you.
About Israel and about the Middle East.